Major funding for these broadcasts has been provided by grants from New York Community Bank, Capital One Bank, Eastern Consolidated, M&T Bank, Sterling National Bank, Meridian Capital Group, Customers Bank, Aerial Property Advisors, Dime Community Bank, Perfect Building Maintenance. Additional funding has been provided by AKA Hotels, Corman Communities, AmTrust Title Insurance Company, AVR Realty Company, Avison Young, Bank of America, Merrill Lynch, Bank Leumi USA, Briarwood Organization, CBRE, Chase Commercial Term Lending, Chase Mortgage Lending, JP Morgan Chase, Citizens Bank, Cohen Equities, Colliers International NYC, Collins Building Services, Connect One Bank, CPEX Real Estate Services, Douglaston Development, Levine Builders, Flushing Bank, Friedman LLP, Handler Real Estate Organization, Handro Properties, Hodges Ward Elliott, Inc., Investors Bank, James D. Kuhn Real Estate Center at Syracuse University, Kilroy Architectural Windows, Madison Realty Capital, Matone Group, Mercantile Bank, New Banks, Newmark Knight Frank, Optimum Window Manufacturing Corp., People's United Bank, Polsinelli, Rockefeller Group, Rosewood Realty Services, SJP Properties, Stonehenge Partners, TD Bank, Terra CRG, The Knackle Group at Cushman & Wakefield, the Marinkoff Family Foundation, the Moynihan Group, and these friends.
Great Neck, Minneapolis, Public Service, Community, Columbia, Wolfenson, Law Firm, Harvard, 9/11, New York City, EDA, EDC, Helping Out, Improvement of Urban Planning, former president of EDC. I have Seth Pinsky today. Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
So tell me about your grandparents and the people who came over originally, the initial.
So my family came over in a couple of different waves.
Let's start on the father's side, then we'll go to mom's side.
My father's family came mostly from Poland. I had, though, a grandfather, my father's father, who arrived via South Africa. He was born in South Africa.
Right, you said in 1906 or something?
1903, I believe. And his family had gone to South Africa from Lithuania via England. They came to New York, and then he grew up in East Harlem.
Right, and then he went into the hardware business?
That's right. His father actually owned a hardware store. He took it over and then ran it until he died. It was on 2nd Avenue.
And then, so tell me a little bit about your mother's side.
My mother's family also came primarily from Poland, as well as from Hungary. Both of my grandparents were born in the United States, and they both grew up in Yonkers. My grandfather's family had been in the pharmaceutical business, maybe in the alcohol business. It's not clear during Prohibition. What happened. My grandfather then went on to become a lawyer and later a city councilman and a judge in Yonkers.
Okay, and let's grandma's side?
My grandmother, her family was the family from Hungary, and she was born in Yonkers and worked in Washington, D.C. during the Depression, and other than that, spent her whole life in Yonkers until very late in life when they moved to Florida.
So let's talk about your dad. An interesting career, an interesting person.
Yeah, he is a rabbi, now retired, but graduated from rabbinical school shortly before I was born, was in a congregation in Great Neck, and then later we moved to New Jersey.
You said Englewood, Tenafly.
Yeah, his congregation was in Tenafly, and we lived in Englewood and then Tenafly, and then we followed him out to what they called the Land of the Frozen Chosen in Minneapolis, where he had a congregation for a number of years.
You were born here.
Born here, born in Yonkers, lived in Great Neck and then Englewood and Tenafly, and then moved to Minneapolis at around age 10.
So let's talk about before age 10 and then after, because you said to me you have good recollections of you, the years that you were here before.
Yeah, I always loved New York, and I think I got that love from my father. He used to enjoy taking me into the city. We would go, our whole family, but frequently my father and I would take the bus from New Jersey and come in. And my recollection is of a much grittier New York, a place that in some ways was a scarier New York, but also a very interesting place. It was a place where you were constantly being assaulted, not physically, fortunately, in my case, but by noise and smell. And it just was
especially
endlessly...
when you were coming over the George Washington Bridge.
Absolutely.
And then you would see, you know, the crisis of what happened in the Bronx, because it was early at that.
Yeah, no, and Upper Manhattan too, burnt out buildings, you know, abandoned lots. But it was also just a place that seemed to have no limits to it, and to be a place with a fascinating history and a diversity that you couldn't match anywhere else.
Let's talk about growing up in Minneapolis. What was it like?
So,
as you were saying, frozen.
Yes, it was a very cold winters, beautiful summers. We lived in a suburb of Minneapolis, about a 15 or 20 minute drive from downtown. I went to a private school, so I would go into Minneapolis frequently. My high school is right near downtown. It's a very nice city. I knew from the day that we moved there that I would be leaving and coming back to New York.
But you said when we got together, you knew that you wanted to do public service.
Yeah, you know, having a grandfather who had been a judge, and a father who was a rabbi, the idea of doing well by the community and public service were always something that were not just drilled into my head, but that were kind of values that I was raised on. And from a very early age, I thought that I wanted to work in government in some capacity. I think at first, my thought was elective office. Later on, as I kind of got to know myself a little bit better, maybe doing something in an appointed position might be a better fit for me.
And what do you do during the summers in Minneapolis?
For years, I went to camp. The synagogue that my father was a rabbi at had a camp out on a lake. There are lots of those in Minneapolis. Then later on, I actually ended up working there, made great friends, had great experience, learned that I enjoy being with young children, which was a nice thing to know.
So when, as you said before, you knew you wanted to come back to New York. So when you graduated high school, how did you decide to go to Columbia?
The decision actually was a relatively easy one. I told my parents very early on that my intention was to come back to New York, that I was going to come back to New York as soon as I was able to make the choice, my assumption being that would be at college. And my father basically said to me, if you want to go to college in New York and you want us to pay for it, Columbia is the place you have to go.
So it was a simple decision.
It was a simple decision. So that was a decision that I stuck with, and that was my goal from that point forward.
So let's talk about the years at Columbia. Tell me about them.
It was a great experience. I think I got an unbelievable education. As I mentioned, the reason I went there was because of its location, and I frankly didn't pay enough attention to everything else about the school, but the core curriculum was an eye-opening experience. I made great friends, but most importantly, the education I think that you got from being in New York, and especially the New York of the late 80s and the early 90s, made me, I think, a much more well-rounded person than I would have been had I come out of any other school. I cannot speak highly enough about the experience that I had there.
So how did you get the opportunity to work for James Wolfensohn?
So that happened
during the summer.
Yeah, my sophomore year, I wanted to stay in New York, not go back to Minneapolis, and I was looking for a job. as with a lot of sophomores in college, was not having a lot of luck. And fortunately, someone helped make a connection for me at Wolfenson, and they offered me a job working in their library back when investment banks had libraries. My job was to file things and to pull files when requested. And over the course of the summer, I was asked to do research projects and little tasks here and there. And eventually, at the end of the summer, they asked me if I wanted to come back for another summer as a summer analyst. And then after that, they asked me if I wanted to come back full time. So I kind of fell into the job.
Right. So when you were over there at Wolfenson, you had Volker.
Yep.
Volker was the chairman of James Wolfenson. Okay. And so when you graduated Columbia, before going to law school, which you always knew that you wanted to go to law school, you stayed at Wolfenson for what, 2 years?
2 years. That's right. Yeah. It was important to me that I work in public service. That was a goal that I didn't want to get diverted from. And I knew working in banking that it was possible that I might get pulled in a different direction. So before I started working at Wolfenson, I decided to take the LSAT, with the thinking being that if I had the LSAT finished, it would force me to apply to law school, and law school would be the path eventually to get into government. So at the end of the 2 years at Wolfenson, despite everyone's recommendation to the contrary, I applied to law school, and that's the direction I went.
Now, the question was, you were a Columbia graduate. How come you decided to make the trip up to Boston?
Well,
to Harvard.
You know, I actually ended up choosing between Columbia and Harvard Law School. And my heart pulled me towards Columbia because of the experience I had, because it would have allowed me to stay in New York. But it was hard to say no to a Harvard degree. And so I made the decision to spend 3 years in the land of the Red Sox.
So in the land of the Red Sox, the summers, one summer you were with one corporate law firm.
Yeah, it was called Howard Darby and Levin. And it was a great experience, a really nice firm, very interesting firm. They gave me a chance, which I was very grateful for. And then the second summer I was at Cleary Gottlieb, where I eventually went to work after law school.
So you graduated law school when?
I graduated in 1998.
And so it's 1998. You had spent the summer at Cleary. You get involved with Cleary, but you get involved in banking, really, as we would say, the collateralized mortgage-backed security business, which is banking, but really more of a collateral.
Yeah, I was in, Cleary technically doesn't have departments, but to the extent that there are departments, I was working in the real estate department and was focused more on the real estate end of loans that were then destined for CMBS issuances. But over the course of my time there, got involved a little bit on the CMBS side as well. Obviously had to understand what the ultimate goal of the loans, the destination of the loans was. And over the course of my time, what I found to be interesting was, for the first couple of years, frankly, I wasn't exactly sure what I was doing. By year two, I had a pretty good handle on the work that we were doing. And for the next year or two after that, I felt pretty confident. And then I started to find myself getting confused again as the loans and the way that they were sliced and diced got more and more complicated, which probably was a signal of what was happening in the market more broadly. But at the time, I just was confused.
Now, what happens on 9/11? You're in Washington. Tell me the story.
So 9/11, I was in Washington for a business meeting. And the morning started in a hotel room where I was getting ready, and I saw the images on television of the first plane having hit the World Trade Center. I called my parents, let them know that I was in Washington, not in New York, because Cleary's offices were across the street from the World Trade Center. Then went into Washington to Cleary's office in downtown Washington. And a few minutes later, I got a knock on the door in the office where I was sitting, and somebody said, "I think there's a fire out the window." So we went to a balcony and looked out, and as we were looking at smoke rising in front of us, I said, "You know, I don't know Washington very well, but I think that's the Pentagon that's on fire." And so we went in and started watching the television and learned of everything else that was happening in the world. Were very quickly evacuated from Washington, went to the home of a colleague of mine, and then watched the rest of the day's events unfold on somebody's couch.
But that had a major effect on your life.
It did. Well, first of all, it was my 30th birthday. Obviously, it changed the course of that day, certainly from what I had planned it to be. Second of all, it also just impacted me as a human being, looking at what had happened to the city that I loved, looking at what had happened to people, most of whom I didn't know, but you know, who were in a similar world to the world that I was in. And what really ended up happening was that Cleary, because we were across the street from the World Trade Center, was forced to evacuate its offices for a number of months. And when we came back, I would sit in my office, which had previously overlooked the towers and now overlooked a hole in the ground, and I would watch the ceremonies as they would find bodies or body parts in the rubble and coat them with an American flag, drape them with an American flag, and then drive them out of the pit with everyone saluting. And I would watch that and think to myself, you know, I've spent all these years talking about wanting to do public service. So far, I haven't done it. If there's ever a time to do it, now is the time. And so I resolved in my head that I was going to somehow get involved in the rebuilding of New York.
So how do you get involved with the rebuilding?
Well, it was somewhat of a circuitous route. I started looking at LMDC, the Lower Manhattan Development Corporation, which had been originally tasked with the redevelopment and kept hitting dead ends, and found myself unable to break in to any of the rebuilding efforts. And one day I went out to lunch with a former colleague from Wolfenson, who was involved in city things, and was telling her of my frustration. And he said, well, have you thought about the EDC? And my immediate response was no, because I don't know what the EDC is. And so she told me about the Economic Development Corporation and suggested that I speak to people that she knew. And so I went in and met with a group of people who were all recent Bloomberg appointees who had come, in most cases, out of the financial world, people that had spoke the same language as I did, had a very similar perspective on the world that I had, and decided that was a good fit.
And to take a two-thirds cut in pay.
It was a significant pay cut, yes. You know, my thinking was, well, I'll do this for a couple of years. I'll see how the experience is. I had some savings at the time. In the worst case scenario, I'd go back to the law, but hopefully it would be something that I like.
So let's talk about EDC and then Hudson Yards and other things and working for Dan Doktoroff.
So my original intention working at EDC was to work on the Hudson Yards project, which I was told about during my interviews.
This was the Hudson Yards jet project.
Correct. Well, it was jets plus everything
else.
Yeah. And it was an exciting project that was at its very early stages. But as it turned out, the person who hired me at the time didn't really have the authority to put me on the Hudson Yards project. So I tried to break into Hudson Yards, very quickly realized that it wouldn't be possible, and found myself for a little while thinking that I didn't have any real responsibilities. As it turned out, it was a lucky break because I used the opportunity to kind of put myself onto projects that I thought of as orphan projects, projects that were out there that sounded interesting that weren't really going anywhere. And through that, I got to know how city government worked, and I got to know the people in city government, and eventually found my way into the world of Dan Doktoroff, who put me onto Hudson Yards. And that was really the start of an exciting career in city government.
So let's talk from where that took you.
So after working for about a year on Hudson Yards, because of the work that I had done previously with Dan, who was the deputy mayor of economic development, he felt that there were a number of large complex projects that the city had in the pipeline that needed somebody with financial expertise and legal expertise. And he had seen that I had those both from the previous work that I had done. And he asked me if I would leave Hudson Yards and go back to the main business of EDC and help him on negotiating and structuring those transactions.
Some of that included the relationship for the Freedom Tower?
Yep. Yeah, that was really one of the most exciting experiences I had. You know, at a certain point, we realized that the project wasn't going anywhere. There had been a number of groundbreakings that the governor had attended, and after the groundbreakings, the cornerstone would sit there and nothing would follow. And we knew that there was a problem, but the state really didn't want the city involved with it. And then one day, Silverstein came to EDC and said, we'd like to access Liberty bonds, which were tax-exempt bonds that had been created after 9/11. And we realized that that was our hook, that that was how we were going to be able to get information about what was going on at the Ground Zero. And the conclusion that we reached was that everyone was actually acting rationally, but that the business arrangement was such that it would never lead to a rebuilding at the Trade Center. And so we worked very hard in partnership with the Port Authority and ultimately in very close partnership with Silverstein to restructure the deal. And after that, the project finally started to move forward.
Some other projects that we were involved with before you became president of the VDC?
Well, it was actually a large range of the higher profile projects that the city was working on involved projects like Willits Point and the redevelopment there, Coney Island.
Right, the Coney Island, Willits Point was a major because of the possible condemnation over the community. Coney Island was a major redevelopment, especially with Luna Park.
Yes, exactly. Trying to figure out how to, by that point, there was only one amusement park left in Coney Island. We were trying to figure out how to revive the larger community, but also the amusement district, and then the Yankees and Mets stadiums, as well as Atlantic Yards. So it was a very exciting time to be in government.
So how did you get the opportunity to become president of VDC?
I'd like to say that it was because I earned it, but I really think I fell into it. It was towards the end of what was supposed to be Mayor Bloomberg's last term, his second term. Dan Doktoroff moved on to Bloomberg LP, and Bob Lieber, who had been president of EDC, was asked by the mayor to replace Dan. And I got a call from City Hall saying, you know, now that Bob is leaving, you may want to think about your own future at EDC. My intention at that point had been to leave city government. I had spent 5 years, it was 2.5 times what I thought I was going to do, I was kind of tired at that point. But I decided to throw my hat in the ring, and I think because it was the end of the administration, the mayor was looking for someone who knew what was going on and could put a pretty bow around what we had been working on and hand it on to the next administration as in as much of a finished state as possible. So I got the job.
And there were some major projects, Homeport, which we have a picture of the groundbreaking in Staten Island, the East River Ferry.
Yeah.
How did that come about, the ferry system?
Well, there had been a number of private ferries which the city had supported. The ferries, because they were largely private affairs, when the economics didn't work anymore, the operators would come to the city and say, we need more subsidy. And it was not a very well thought out system. And so these ferries would start and stop, and people were very frustrated. So we decided at EDC to do a study and to look at what we thought were routes that could actually be financially viable. So we put together a proposal for a first route, which is what the original East River Ferry was, from Midtown across through Queens and Brooklyn and then back to Lower Manhattan. And it turned out to be even more successful than we had thought, which fortunately the de Blasio administration has now picked up on and significantly expanded, which is great for the city.
Let's talk about Roosevelt Island and Cornell Tech.
So that was a project that grew out of 2008 in the financial crisis. And the mayor pulled together, right after the crash of Lehman Brothers, his economic development team and said, we need to do something. When he left the room, we all kind of stared at each other because the sky was falling and we weren't sure what we as city government could do. One of the things that came out of that was an initiative that we called our Game Changers Initiative. And the Game Changers Initiative involved asking as many people as we could think of, if there were one thing that you could change about New York City that you think would have the most dramatic impact on our economy, what would it be? And what we started to hear very consistently was that although we have some of the best universities in the world, if you look around the world at the most successful economies, those economies have at their core a critical mass of applied sciences, research, and development. And relative to the scale of the city and the scale of our ambitions, we just didn't have enough of that. So we decided to launch a competition where we asked universities around the world to come to us with ideas for how they could create that critical mass here in New York. And in exchange for that, we would offer some financial support and potentially land if people wanted. And what came out of that were a number of new applied sciences programs. There was a new program that Carnegie Mellon launched at the Brooklyn Navy Yard. NYU and a consortium of international universities started something called the Center for Urban Science and Progress in downtown Brooklyn. Columbia significantly expanded its engineering school. And then the largest project was a $2 billion project proposed by Cornell and the Technion, which is a leading engineering school from Israel on Roosevelt Island. And it happened to have just opened its doors, which is really exciting.
Then there was also the involvement with Hunters Point, the housing, the largest affordable housing in the Queens.
Yeah, we had some issues with payments that we were required to make to the Port Authority. The Port Authority had some land in Queens that were part of Queens West that didn't seem to be moving everywhere. And so we negotiated the acquisition of the land in Queens West for Hunters Point South, which was the largest middle-income housing development in New York since Starrett City.
Right. With a couple of minutes left, I just want to, I know you were ready to leave the administration and then Hurricane Sandy came on, and you were involved with the rebuilding on Hurricane Sandy, correct?
Yeah, less on the rebuilding and more on the long-term the planning. Right. Yeah, so my son had just been born and I was planning on leaving, and I got a call from Bob Steele, who was the deputy mayor of economic development, asking me if I'd be willing to stay for a few months to think about how New York should deal with climate change going forward. So we put together a team and came up with a $20 billion plan that sought to make New York more resilient in the face not just of storm surge like Hurricane Sandy brought, but all of the future effects of climate change.
You brought up your son. Let's talk about how you met your wife. You're married and you have two children.
Yes, so we met in the Bloomberg administration. Right. Yes, and she worked for the deputy mayor, so I guess technically she was my boss. We started dating at first on the sly, and eventually people figured out what was going on, got married, now have two kids, Theo, who is about to turn 5, and Amelia, who's about to turn 3.
And you're living in Brooklyn?
We live in Brooklyn in Park Slope.
And your wife now works for Abney, right?
Correct. She is the executive director of Abney.
And with like a minute and a half, let's talk about what you're doing with RXR today.
So at RXR, I am focusing on what we refer to as emerging submarkets, which are parts of the New York region where there's been underinvestment and underdevelopment. And we're looking for opportunities in those places to bring private capital to the table, to partner with municipalities, and to try to do the things, frankly, that we did during the Bloomberg administration in underprivileged neighborhoods around the city, to bring economic activity, to create new housing, to create new opportunities for the people who live there, and to try also to help to solve some of the problems that our region is facing with affordable housing by creating affordable options for people in transit accessible places.
So it's fortuitous that dad would take you on the bus and drive into the city, so you learned about the city and you lived the city. And you've been so important in the redevelopment of the city, and thank you for being here today.
Thank you so much.